Hi folks, I'm really glad you're here. This is a very brief course. It's on women, women as mothers, the feminine, and Mother Earth. And I want to start by saying how appreciative I am that we are able to be here to even reflect on these issues, because all across the world, women and children, men, elders, are fleeing for their lives, are in camps, are starving, couldn't possibly spend time even sitting down. So as we begin, could we just close our eyes for a moment and imagine that we're here for a large percentage of the world that doesn't have the luxury of stopping to think. And as you're doing that, I want you to also remember that you stand on the shoulders of ancestors, women and men, mothers, grandmothers, whose lives were often not taken seriously. And much of the trauma that women have dealt with and continue to deal with is intergenerational, historical issues of class, race, and poverty. So having said that, feel free to open your eyes. So we're here for a lot more than just ourselves. I want to start by saying that lip service is given to how women are important and mothers are important, our mothers are important. But in fact, our society is not organized around the feminine. It is not organized around women. It is not organized around happiness or around children. It is organized around productivity. And it is organized around the notion that people don't do it for us, goods and products do it for us. It's our cell phone. I mean, babies get hooked to the cell phone the first days that they see their parents, their caretakers, focused like this on the cell phone, and then that becomes the object that they know must be the most important. Whew, big sigh. To know that we're in a society that isn't organized around our human needs, and that includes the feminine in all human beings. That which is nurturing, that which is vulnerable, that which is tender and embraces the whole, as much in men as it is in women. And I'm going to be doing a special class on the special sensitivity and vulnerability of boys and men, and how under a system that is very patriarchal, we have hurt our boys and men, as well as girls and women. But I wanted you to understand this, because you really can't get a sense of what you deal with if you don't look at the larger social and historical perspective. Does that make sense? Okay, so having said that, it's hard to be a mother these days. It's hard to care for the earth, whether you're a mother gardener in the form of a male body, whether you are a nanny or a doula or a midwife or a granny or an elder or an auntie. It's really hard to do the work of nurturing and caretaking in a world that has not designed an economic system to care about the work you do. Child care workers get some of the bottom wages in this culture. The turnover rate in daycare centers for infants is up to 3 a year. So a child may be cared for by 2 or 3 different people a day, and then 3 different caretakers of those 2 or 3 every couple of months as somebody leaves because it's not valued enough to pay well. That's the nature of things. Now, I'm here to say that it can change, and that it is changing, and that there is a rising consciousness about the critical nature of the feminine. Call it the sacred feminine, whether you're raising bees or babies. This is what is going to allow our species to continue. But if it doesn't have any economic value, and it doesn't, and if the economic system is not even such that women get equal pay for equal work, much less that men and women get equal pay for comparable work for being the gardeners of the future, for being the caretakers of the developing human brain, then it's going to be very challenging for each of us to try and shift that system, to try and get days off as a new dad, to try and get 6 or 9 months off with job security at the other end so that we don't have to put our baby in daycare at 6 weeks of age. But that's what we're doing. And I say this so that we can take some of the burden of responsibility and the feelings of guilt that many of us have, that we aren't doing all the job that we'd really like to for our kids or for anything that we're nurturing in our life. We're under enormous stress right now at this time in history, and we're making the best of it. And we're built to survive, and we have an incredible amount of inner resilience. But along with that, we have some sensitivity. And when it comes to actual mothers themselves, from the time a woman becomes pregnant, conceives, she is like a porous vessel. Everything that comes into her, comes to her, goes into her. We used to think that the placenta, for example, was a barrier that protected babies from harm. Now we know that toxins from the mother's body, toxins from the air she breathes, from the cigarettes she smokes, from the cortisol and adrenaline in her system because she's being abused or because she's poor or because she simply has to work 10 hours a day and travel to and from, didn't get to the baby. It does. It goes straight to the baby. And this period of time in the womb, we don't think of as being very important because if we did, we would set guidelines in our society and set up our systems to really pay attention to women and to the feminine and to those who are nurturing elders or those who are differently abled. So some of what I want to do today is to give you a perspective, a lens through which to view your lives and what's going on in this society as women and men. And some of what I want you to, I hope to do, is to get you excited about these issues so that you will begin to question and to be better detectives, to be more conscious voters, to get involved at the community level, and to realize that what is going on with the feminine has been going on in terms of oppression and an attempt to really eradicate it since the beginning of patriarchal systems. But along with that, and I'm going to be talking about this in the class on boys and men have suffered from patriarchal systems as much as women, perhaps worse. It's because they've been socialized not to even express what they're feeling. So we'll talk about that more in that class, but I do want you to understand that patriarchal systems have damaged everyone. Now, when we started out, as human beings, we were gatherers and hunters, and we lived in small bands. And yes, there were stresses. And yes, there were roles that women were expected to do versus men. And at the same time, men were the ones often who were present when a woman gave birth. And they saw the and felt the enormity of it and had the experience of awe and reverence. As we moved forward in time, it was women who began agriculture. It was women who began protecting the seeds, caring for the seeds, and growing the crops. And it was men who began storing the grain and realizing that profit could be made from storing. This is not part of what the feminine does. What the feminine principle does is make sure that everybody gets enough to eat. It looks forward to the children, the grandchildren, future generation. The feminine, whether you're in a masculine body or a female body, the feminine side of you is looking at the big picture. And I'll give you an example how in some of the villages in Central America, it's the men who go to the meetings and have the right to vote. The women aren't granted the right to vote. They're supposed to cook for the men so they can go to the meeting. And they make decisions such as, we're going to sell that piece of land to whoever is raising cattle for McDonald's so that we can buy money, get money so that we can buy shoes for our kids and we can buy portable radios or cell phones, whatever. Well, it turns out the land they sold was what the women cultivated or used to get the sap, the herbs, the roots that went into the preparations and the additions to their minimal diet that kept everyone healthy and got them healthy when they were sick. So the men were looking short term, the women were looking long term, and it didn't change until usually someone from the outside, male or female, comes in, spots what's going on, honors and values the feminine side of things, starts to record the remedies that the women know, starts to give them a sense of respect and dignity for what they're doing, and helps them bang on the door of the building that says women can't vote and say, sorry, I'm not feeding you tonight unless we get in there to vote. And wherever this has happened around the world, decisions are made differently and more for the benefit of the whole group than just for a few. But I want to go back. This is not the way our society is organized. It's not the way the Industrial Revolution shifted things for us. But even before that, patriarchal values and ideals cut very, very deep into the feminine. And most of us have as ancestors people who may have been burned at the stake or named heretics for being the healthiest women in the society and for bringing children into the world. Long history of masculine domination that has ended up in hospital practices and interventions that have nothing to do with the biological process. So, women aren't socialized to think about this, neither are new dads socialized to think about the fact that giving drugs to women in labor may interfere with the hormones, because they're sexual hormones, the hormones that govern labor. The hormones that govern labor can't work the same if the natural hormones secreted by the woman's body aren't produced because of the drugs given in order to either keep her quiet, make her docile, or simply speed along the labor, because we've got other women waiting and hospitals are designed for staffing needs. They're not designed for what the biological process needs. So, along with this, what's happened is we have placed people in positions of power who don't really understand the normal biological, physiological, much less sexual, emotional dimensions of bringing a human being into the world, or honoring them and giving them respect. And I'll give you an example of three generations ago. Now, I'm 72. In 1936, my mother gave birth to my brother. And at that time, Twilight Sleep was in fashion. Now, that was the mixture of narcotics and analgesic drugs to make women docile patients and to render them unconscious so that forceps could be used to pull the baby out. Didn't have any problem with the woman. She was inert. She was lying on her back. Problem was, it made women insane. They became wild. And they would stand up on the bed, they would punch the nurse, they would curse. So women were tied 4-point. They were tied with restraints used from the mental hospitals. And they would wake up after this birth, often didn't see their baby for a full day, sometimes a couple days. Baby would be cared for in the nursery because the nursery was required whenever we started to make women unconscious because they couldn't hold their babies. They weren't awake, and they couldn't be left alone with their babies. So we end up with the nursery that we still have today. So women came out of these experiences of twilight sleep birth feeling vaguely ashamed. Like they must have done something wrong. They don't know what it was. There'd be scratches all over their body because they would also scratch themselves. And those practices of separating mothers and babies continue today for absolutely no reason. We have neonatologists fighting for the first sacred hour to keep the mother and baby together. We have parents fighting not to have the umbilical cord, the lifeline to the mother's body and to her heartbeat and to all of the oxygenated blood as the backup for their own breathing, to be cut. Why? Because we started cutting it because we could separate the mother and baby. Once we had cord blood, we could save it for our child who might get sick 10 years later. We started cutting cords 15 seconds after birth. So this is just an example about how so much of what we deal with in birth itself and then in afterbirth in separating the mother and baby has really nothing to do with biology. And it has nothing to do with what serves nature. Now, an obstetrician named Michel Odant wrote many books, but one of the most important books he wrote was about the comparison between mechanized farming and mechanized birth. And the fact that the kinds of things we put on the land in order to be able to grow more crops more quickly is exactly the same as what we have been doing to mothers and babies in birth, not respecting biology because we didn't understand it. So here we have a society that has a third of its women having cesarean births. And virtually no one is saying to this woman who may even be asking for a cesarean birth because she's so frightened of labor, because she herself had a traumatic birth and doesn't know anything about it, wasn't told anything about it. She isn't told anything about what she or the baby misses out on by having a cesarean rather than a vaginal birth. We couch it in terms of the risks of the cesarean or the potential benefits, but what about all of the benefits of having a normal physiological, biological birth, which is vaginal, no drugs, no induction, no speeding up, no separating of the mother and baby, and giving her all that she needs in terms of privacy, in terms of support, in order to really do this labor, this rhythmic labor where she can learn to ride the contractions instead of feeling like she's underneath them, right? Well, the hospital isn't set up that way, and actually hospitals aren't designed for birth anyway. So you have to really ask, why are we birthing our babies in a place that has drugs, that has germs that only exist, superbugs, in hospitals, where it's an environment designed for the sick? Well, it's kind of like the outlawing of the small family farm. We didn't have to outlaw home birth or the small family farm per se. All we had to do was give all the subsidies to big farmers to do monocrops, which are much more, make plants much more susceptible to disease, but you can plant more of them. So when we talk about this, we're talking about interventions that nobody has questioned because they came following earlier interventions that we had never questioned and never examined scientifically. It's only in the last few years we actually have something called evidence-based medicine. And it started in Oxford, England, with obstetrics, looking at, well, is there really evidence to show that giving drugs to the woman in labor makes it an easier labor? It turns out a doula is more effective than drugs, but it doesn't have the negative effects. So, as we talk about women and birth and babies and farming practices in a modern society, in an industrial society where everything is built for profit and for speed and efficiency, what we've lost sight of is that the feminine isn't about speed and efficiency and profit. The feminine is about that which supports and sustains life. And if we create passive patients, which is what most birth education classes offer in the hospital. They offer free classes to socialize you, to be passive, and to accept what the society wants. This is why I'm in such favor of independent birth classes. The same way I'm in favor of doulas who are able to work for the normal process and the mother and baby rather than for an institution and can fire them if they question what's going on. It's why I'm so in favor of the midwifery model of care, which is that of protecting and supporting the woman's body, protecting and supporting the normal process, just the way you would protect, support, and nurture a hive of bees. And we all know now how vulnerable humans are to the destruction of the bees. So you can see how the feminine farming practices, modern maternity care, hospital obstetrics, all fits together. We have a society that is designed to deliver babies and to deliver artificial formula called milk into babies' bodies through bottles. Unfortunately, this artificial substance bears almost no resemblance to what a mother's body produces, which has unbelievable, actually untold benefits. We're just beginning to understand them. It's kind of like what we did with flour in the 1950s when we got really excited about bleached flour, and then we enriched the bleached flour by adding back a couple of nutrients, but it wasn't what whole flour was. It was just enriched. When I grew up, and my mother, who tried very hard to give fresh food to all of us every day, even though she was a hardworking school teacher. She was very dedicated to this, but we had degerminated cornmeal in the closet. Well, I thought that meant it had no bugs in it and it was really good. I had no idea what the germ was at the center of the kernel of corn, which had all the protein, right? So, what I'm asking is that as we think about women and mothers and birth and maternity care and breastfeeding and why women are getting so many drugs in pregnancy for depression and anxiety and as new moms instead of getting what they really need, and why women are getting so many drugs in birth instead of being prepared to labor, that labor is designed to prepare women to mother, to nurture a baby. I think it's really important that we recognize what we've lost and recognize that just as you can't expect a plant to grow alone without enough water, without enough sunlight, in a hostile environment, why would we expect that a woman and baby should be left alone hours a day? No culture in their right mind would ever do this. It would understand that they are both vulnerable and that the needs of a baby, because they are full-time, need to be shared by the entire community. So when I think about birth and the feminine, and I think about the sacred feminine, and I think about the principle that honors life and protects the nurturers and protects the life givers, then I'm looking at, why aren't we doing sex education in our schools? Why aren't we giving women access to all the contraceptive methods? Why aren't we teaching family planning? Why is it that the government gets to defund Planned Parenthood when that is the, or attempts to, when that is the only organization in many towns where a young girl can go to learn about her body, because we're not even teaching the physiology of our bodies, much less the incredible sophistication of the human body and how we are part of the natural system. So it's not just nature. We are nature. Nature, nurture. It's not nature out there, we are nature. And the more we war on nature, the less we feel good about ourselves. So it goes back to the question at the beginning. In this society, which I never fully named, in this society, in the modern society that we live in now, how can we cherish, support, nurture those who are most sensitive, the most sensitive sides of men as well as women, the most vulnerable, that's our elders, those who are sick, our babies. How can we do so when we have values that are competing? And the value is for production. And the value is for making yourself valuable in financial terms, when the work you're really doing, whether it's planting seeds or rocking a baby or holding a toddler for as long as that toddler needs to be held when he's fallen down, are not accorded any honor or value. So that's what I hope you'll go home with today. I hope you'll have more respect for what it is you do that is feminine, that is the sacred, and for questioning what's going on all around us and looking at where we can find people to join us as a community of elders and young people and women and men and mothers and people who are never going to have children because we were all born. And we were all shaped by those experiences from in the womb to the first year after. Where can we find the community we need to make our voices heard? Ooh, a lot to think about, right? So let's take a break and we'll have some questions. What's your name?
Andrew.
Hi, Andrew. Do you have a comment or a question?
I really liked your lecture, and I was thinking about the what you talked about, the birthing process, and with my two boys, we had natural births, and I was there for the whole thing, and was really there to support my wife through it all, and you know, when she was recovering, you know, I was actually able to have my baby skin to skin with me, which was really, you know, nice and, you know, really enjoyable for me, because in, I've actually chose to be a stay-at-home dad for the past 3 years, and also do a little bit of gardening with the Pine River Garden Club and here at the community garden, and yeah, I just really enjoying it, and yeah, things are going great.
Can you say something about any connection you make between gardening and being a parent?
And I think definitely there's a connection between being a parent and a gardener. You know, just seeing both of them grow, you have to give them the right conditions, you know, to be happy and thrive and, yeah, grow into mature plants and mature babies and toddlers and human beings. We have to give them care and love and, well, you know, I was working at the time, you know, my wife was pregnant, but we decided that one of us needed to stay home just because childcare is expensive and she was making more money at the time. And so we just decided to, you know, go with her career and, you know, me be a stay-at-home dad. So, and it's worked out well for both of us.
What's your name?
Jesse.
Hi, Jesse. Anything strike a chord with you or you want to ask a question?
I loved it all. I thought it was really pertinent to a lot of things that I think about. I'm a mom of one boy. He's 5 years old in preschool now, and he's wonderful. And, you know, my biggest goal in my life is to raise him to be a caring and compassionate man and to, you know, to take care of other people. And it's a hard thing to do, especially for a boy. You feel like you need to teach them to be tough, or that's what you should do. And my husband and I, who's a great dad, we definitely talk about how I'm more of a coddler than he is. And it's nice to come to a class like this and have it reinforce that that is actually okay and maybe even good. So I really appreciate that. And I work part-time, which was a choice that we made as a family. I wanted to keep that, you know, adult brain connection going. I really enjoy what I do. I make maps for a land management agency, and I really enjoy that type of work, but I wanted to have a good amount of time with my child. And so for me, it's been a really wonderful balance. And I've learned over the years that I'm very much I want to fix things. I'm a fixer. And so coming to a talk like this, I wish I knew more what I could do to make things better for, you know, for a society that cares more about nurturing. And so I think just leaving here and pondering that and, you know, trying to be more active in the community and in our, just all of it, to try to make those changes. So I'm very thankful for coming. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, when people are in a state that Maslow calls, you know, like the low end of the triangle, they're just getting their core needs met or not for food, for safety. It's really hard to think much about the impact of climate change. They've got a kid with asthma and they're not going to make that connection with what's the pollutants that are pouring into the inner city that where their baby or child lives. It's up to us, we who have the privilege of a little time, to be able to do things that will help other people. One of the things we can do is to join groups that are trying to raise food security, like we have one in our community, to volunteer and to listen deeply to what the issues are that mothers have. Often you'll hear mothers and fathers, when asked what to do with the tax money that came down from, let's say, tobacco use that went to communities, what do we really want to do with that money? They'll say childcare. They won't say we want maternity leave and paternity leave and we want it paid and we want job security after we're home for 9 months or a year, because they grow up in a society that has socialized them to believe that other people can do better for their kids than they can. But when you listen to them and what they makes them sad, it will be the lack of time they have with their children and the amount of frustration, short temper, anger that their kids get because they're under such stress. So when you think about what you can do, just look around you at who the most underserved people are in the community. And being there to help them figure out what they want and then get their needs met as adults so that they can meet the needs of kids is a big step forward. And you're doing it against the grain of modern society. So don't expect it to be easy. What's your name?
Judy.
Hi, Judy. Tell me what struck you or what did you want to talk about or question?
So many things struck me. I really enjoyed it. It was very meaningful, your talk. And it made me more aware of how grateful I should be as a 76-year-old mother and grandmother, how I was able to realize the needs and the joys of natural childbirth, of nursing,
wow.
And despite the fact that my favorite aunt, my doctor, so many people around me, oh, why would you want to do that? What, even the anesthesiologist poked his head in after my firstborn and said, are you sure you don't want a little something? And I said, my baby is here.
You were one of the first people to choose to have a natural birth in those days. The women who had unmedicated births in the 40s, 50s, 60s were usually black women who were put in the basement of the hospitals to labor, at least especially in the South, to labor in the hospital alone. They weren't given any support at all. They also weren't given dangerous drugs. So a lot of these women ended up having scary births, but they discovered they could do it, and the baby wasn't taken away from them. Isn't that ironic?
It is indeed, and I was also fortunate enough to have my husband, they would not let him come in for the birth, but he came up to the door.
That's amazing.
He was there right after my kids were born, both children.
And what's been your work? Have you worked with kids?
I'm a teacher, and I know that I'm a very giving person. And I have tried to nurture that in my children as well. And the other thing, another thing that I'm in the middle of reading this, my second book by an author called Ferenc Matei. And it's about Tuscany, the hills of Tuscany, and this one is called The Wisdom of Tuscany. And you encapsulated so briefly but so well the main thoughts in these books of the need for community, of intergenerational activity, of enjoying nature, of growing, and it just of our need for things rather than and not valuing contact.
Right. That's why this series is called The Human Attachment Project. I feel that attachment at the core is probably the biggest betrayal that we've experienced since the Industrial Revolution, when people started being pulled away from the land and pulled away from their families, and then we put children in factories, and it goes on and on. And now we've got all these gadgets that we pay for, but don't have the time to luxuriate with having a cup of tea with a friend or taking a walk with kids in nature. We do, but we think we don't. And I'm not exalting tribal life or life in villages early. I mean, there was a lot going on that was not what we would want to do today. The options were much fewer. There was a lot of questioning of anything that was new. I mean, even in a place like Ethiopia, where I went and saw people living in huts that were shaped conically and didn't have a hole in the roof for the smoke, and the women were working over the brazier, the charcoal coffee roaster, mm-hmm. all day long, and blindness is the affliction of older people in that culture. And I can only imagine if a bright kid had said, well, Mom, why don't we have a hole in the ceiling and let the smoke out? That would have been completely shushed. It's not the way we've always done it. So I'm not saying that earlier human beings had it so much easier. I'm simply saying that we've paid the price for a lot of the so-called sophistication that we have, and a lot of it is out of place and really hurtful. Hi, what's your first name?
Hi, my name's Amy.
Hi, Amy. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me. Yeah. I wanted to say everything about your talk resonated with me, and what it takes me to mostly is, as a doula, I'm a practicing doula and training to be a yoga therapist, is I really feel like this is a great introduction to all of these different topics that run so deep, and there's so much information about all of it. But when I first got pregnant with my first child 4 years ago, I didn't know anything. I didn't know anything about what I wanted to do, about this process, about parenting, about labor, about birth. So I just kind of dove headfirst into it and had a couple preconceived notions about, okay, well, you know, I'll just follow along with what everybody else does, with what everybody else says. And it wasn't until I started reading and researching that I was like, oh, I don't want to do anything about with what everybody else does. Like, it really took a lot, and then it was a lot of foraging my own path and finding out what was right for my husband and I, my family, my unborn child. And it was really interesting. I lived in 4 different states when I was pregnant, so I kind of had to reimagine it every time, but each time led to more information, to more of what I wanted to do. And then finally, in our third state, we took a birth class that absolutely changed my life. It changed everything about the trajectory of my life, and it kind of just touched on everything that you have talked about so far, about how we need to listen to ourselves, we need to take time, we need to allow the thought process to like fully develop when we're doing things, not just, you know, checking things off on a timeline, like really.
Wow. Yeah.
So, and it changed my husband completely. Like, mm-hmm. it turned him from somebody who was not in tune with any of this, you know, interested, obviously, because it was our child and he loved us, but not interested necessarily in the birth process and the whole nurturing aspect of it. You know, who's going to be a nurturer, but it wasn't going to be so earth mama-y. And it really opened up that whole world for him, you know, and it's something that then as a 28-year-old man, he just started to explore.
So I want to ask you, who gave you support to question the way things were? Was there somebody in your family? Was there a maternal aunt, a grandmother? I mean, where'd you get this gutsiness to listen to your own voice?
Stubbornness. The authors that I read mostly. As reading your book, a lot of books. I just went to the library and checked out everything, and I would read everything from every different angle, and the things that resonated with me did. But then I remember even, I had no interest in working in the birth field at all, but and I remember reading a book about placenta encapsulation and be like, nope, never. So it pretty much just happened over and over again where I'd be like, no, I think that's a little too edgy, a little too, and then like a couple months down the road, I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna do that. So I think just a stubbornness and an interest in learning and then being, you know, finding my place in the birth community in each different place and talking with my providers and, yeah, I didn't have a leader. And so I feel like this is the leader. This is the kind of thing that can really like start the conversation.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, what I'm hoping in this series is as much as anything that it starts conversations, that it plants a few seeds, which if they get watered by another conversation or an article or something someone sees, that it'll be like, oh yeah, and that people will check in with their gut and listen. So bravo for you for being. What's your name?
My name's Juanita.
Hi, Juanita.
Suzanne.
Tell me, what touched you or a little bit of what it brought up?
I've been a midwife for 38 years, home birth midwife specifically. And one of the things that you spoke to that I have spent my whole career trying to support women in is the concept of sacredness and the divine feminine. And the way that you articulated it was particularly nice today because it identified how someone can look at divine femininity within themselves, but also how to put that into action, how to take that and express it in nurturing life. And I loved the way that you expressed that. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you. Are you a mom, a grandma? What's your...
I have three children. All three were born at home. I have three grandsons. Wow. And continue to have lots of stepkids, as it were, in the clients that I take care of.
Mm. So what do you think it was that set you on a path different from the trajectory that we're being socialized to, which is to accept routine intervention, to accept drugs, to accept hospitals, to accept outside authority. Why not you?
Well, that goes back a lot of years back in history. But for me, as a young woman, I was around women that were having birth outside of the hospital, and it never occurred to me that there was a different way. It was what was normal in the group that I was working around and living around.
Wow.
And so when I found out that most people went to the hospital, it was shocking to me because that's not what my experience had been. So when I was asked to be involved with birth, it was just sort of a natural process to go that way rather than a more hospital-based interventionist kind of process.
Have you found a community of support for you so that you're not feeling alone as someone who's doing things differently?
Well, you create your own community up to a point. You create what you need around you, whether that's through other midwives, through other birth workers, through your clientele and the women that you get to work with. Those become your community. And so as time has gone by, you get to create, or I have created, a way of interacting with people that's nurturing back to me. The benefit of what I do is that I get nurtured by it instead of letting it out.